turn around.
Every now and then I get a little bit lonely and you're never coming around.
Turn around.
Michael from Ray Chair Diaries. It's Saturday, December 15th, 2012, the day after that massacre, basically, in Connecticut. Just want to talk from my heart, as they say. In my family, most of us seem to have depressive personalities, and this week has really been a test. It's been an ordeal. I had my 61st birthday, and I didn't make a big deal of it like I did before when I turned 60, 50, 40, 30. We in the West, we do measure accomplishments and longevity by decades, basically. And I felt that all of those were worth noting, if only for my own sort of record-keeping OCD sort of behavior that I have. And so when I turned 61, it wasn't a big deal, a big service, because birthdays are about getting closer to death, mortality. We may say they're about accomplishments and all of that, but the only birthdays people, really look forward to are the ones where they're going to get a driver's license, the ones where they're going to be able to buy alcohol legally, the ones where they're going to be able to vote, that sort of thing. You know, and when you reach 40, if you double it, you're going to be very close to, even if you have good health, when you die. You know, as long as you can still double them. Like if you're 35, you go, okay, well, I'll probably be alive when I'm 70, so I haven't lived over half my life. But by the time you reach 40. It's pretty close, you know. The actuarial tables favor the women, and the men, I think, are like age 77 by average, something like that, North America. And when you reach 60, like I have, 61, it's highly unlikely that I'm going to be older than 122. So, you know, you reach a point where you look in the rearview mirror and the distance is a lot greater than what's ahead down the highway, okay? So if I've got about 20 years left, that's probably good. My dad died when he was 81. Mom died when she was 88, but she was, you know, had dementia for quite a while before she died. So living to 88, I don't know if that's such a joy, if that's the case, if that's what's in my future. Anyway, a streak of melancholy, as I said, basically runs through my family. So, I don't think I convey myself as a happy, contented person, because that's just the face I have. That's what I inherited. But I am, a very, very contented person. I've had very good luck in my life. I've made good luck. I believe one does create luck as well, you know, through tenacity, through hard work, and being given the gift of not having money is, I think, a savior for a lot of us. Now, I'm not talking abject poverty. Richer people by far are happier than poorer people. But, I mean, as far as creature comforts go, right? But I think if I had been born rich, I think it might have been the unmaking of me. I don't know if I would have had the integrity, the ethics, the fortitude that I have now. So it's been a very, very strange week because of these international incidents and because of personal things. And it's been hard the last 2 days to feel really optimistic and feel really happy. I take antidepressants, but I take like maybe 1/8 of what I was taking 5 years ago, 6 years ago. I'm only taking a small 37.5 milligrams or whatever it is. Now, it used to be over 300. But as I said, my birthday was Tuesday. I turned 61, and after waking up, not long after being up, I get the notice that my sister-in-law Sheila died, my brother Wayne's wife, and she'd been sick for many years and had a blood illness. She had multiple transfusions over the years, and then they couldn't give her any more, and there was no bone marrow donor about to appear. So they only gave her a few days to live, like her system was breaking down and starting to close. And she was 62 pounds. She was never a big woman, but she was crippled with osteoarthritis. She was all hunched over. She was basically had a hunchback by the time. She was only 59. She had her first stroke in her 30s. So how can people have such bad luck, you know? But that kind of puts a pallor on one's birthday when your sister-in-law dies. And she's a sister-in-law that I liked. I like most of them. So I talked to my brother that night after I gave him a chance to deal with all of this. Phoned him. And we had quite a good chat. And then yesterday I went to the funeral and back to the Catholic Church for the funeral, the one that my sister-in-law Lane's mother was buried in. That I was there for that funeral, and I think it's where my mother's funeral was in 2005 when I was there. So the only time I go to church for the last few decades has been funerals and weddings, because I left the church a long time ago, or as I say, the church left me a long time ago, because of its anti-gay stance and the way it treats women. You know, women cannot be equals and things like that. It offends me. And then, you know, abusive priests and Vatican greed and all of that sort of stuff. So I have real issues with the Roman Catholic Church that I was raised in. But, you know, you go to church and the indoctrination is so powerful that, like yesterday, I was wondering, oh, maybe I should go back to the church. I mean, isn't that insane? Like everything that's going on, there's an urn on a table in front of me. There's pictures of my sister-in-law. The priest was a very dynamic priest for a change. And the service was nice. Very much like a Protestant service. The Catholic service, I can't even recognize the service anymore. I mean, there weren't even kneeling boards or whatever they were called. I mean, there was no kneeling in this. I had never heard of this. So things have really changed. But that was all very sad. And then we went for the where the urn was placed, and you know, I said, oh my goodness, like Marilyn Monroe, you know, like it was this outdoor area. But I called it like condos for urns, you know, like each with names. And I think that's actually quite a nice place to have ashes put. I know the spirit is not in the ashes, but I like the idea that there's company. I don't like the whole thing about being in an urn and buried in the ground. It's just not something I don't derive comfort from that. So, and I said to Ted, I said, if I should die before you, put me in one of these places, because I said, you know, I always like living in high rises. So I like, just give me my little urn condo here in one of these places, except it's a Catholic cemetery, so I don't think I'll be allowed in anyway. So that was very, very sad, seeing all of that and being part of that. And then, then when I see on Facebook or something, this whole thing about this shooting Connecticut, I really understand the expression with a heavy heart, because it's like everything. I felt everything yesterday after that. I mean, I had the day off, I was able to come home except for driving Ted back and forth. But my heart was so heavy from this week, that combination of aging and thoughts of mortality, Sheila and her illness and her death, and then these poor kids and teachers and so on. And I really feel that expression, a morass of despair. I really, really feel it today. And it's just, I just feel the weight of these incidents, this the carnage, like overshadowing my personal grief is this whole grief for people I don't know, and how those decimated families. I just, it's really to make you weep, like my eyes have not been dry for a few days. Anyway, I haven't been wailing or anything, but it's there. It's the weepy thing is certainly with me this week. The fact that I could do a video about a James Bond movie, that was just me pulling myself up so I could do that and do something bright that wasn't full of despair. If you're wondering about these two videos being so diametrically opposed that I'm doing today, and I'm going to go into work and try to sell fish for 5 hours. And that's it. We've had snow flurries, so I think we're going to have our first snowstorm. It's just, I know I'm rambling, with the violence, the gun lobby, all of that stuff. I just hate it so much. I don't want to take guns away from hunters or anything like that. There's so many response. Most, of course, gun owners are, of course, completely responsible. My father was a hunter. I don't approve of hunting personally, and I've held those rifles a couple of times, and just empties, they scared me. They used to be on the dining room wall of the house when I was growing up. I just don't have that mindset, that killing gene like that, I mean for firearms and wanting to shoot. But the United States lawmakers, they've got to get some balls. It's going to take women to get the balls. I know it's the women who lead these things, who will make this happen. But the citizenry must rise up and get the laws changed. And I mean, the constitutional right to bear arms was about protection. It was not about having machine guns in your private collection in the city. It was to protect yourself from, insurrection and so on, things like that. So anyway, all the money that's being taken away from mental illness budgets, that's such a big part of it. It really is. I believe that because I just don't think you can be lucid and shoot children in school. I don't think you can be lucid and shoot people in an Oregon shopping mall. And I don't think you can have all your faculties and kill people in a mosque. It's just doesn't make sense to me. Then again, I'm for the most part, I'm politically incorrect, but I'm an extremely sensible person. I think so. Maybe you don't. Anyway, my heart is heavy. I do feel the pain. I do not feel the abject anguish that somebody who loses a child or a father to something like this, or a brother or a sister, can feel. That's ridiculous. That's bogus. I can go into work this afternoon. So my heart is not broken, but I do weep. You know, I can feel sympathy and empathy to only to the degree of being a bystander, an observer of this. But it's just been a sad week. It's been a sad week all around for me, and a sad week all around for the world, really. So I do hope something positive comes out of this. I really do. I think that's about all I can say. I just sad week. And I would say God bless if I believed, but I'll say it anyway, God bless, because he certainly wasn't blessing those children that day.